And I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, "Come and see." And I saw, and behold, a white horse.
There's a man going round taking names, and he decides who to free and who to blame. Everybody won't be treated all the same. There'll be a golden ladder reaching down when the man comes around. The hairs on your arm will stand up at the terror in each sip and in each sup. Will you partake of that last offered cup or disappear into the potter's ground when the man comes around? Hear the trumpets, hear the pipers, 100 million angels singing. Multitudes are marching to the big kettle drum. Voices calling, voices crying. Some are born and some are dying. It's Alpha and Omega's kingdom come. And the whirlwind is in the thorn tree. The virgins are all trimming their wicks. The whirlwind is in the thorn tree. It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. Till Armageddon, no shalom, no shalom. Then the father hen will call his chickens home. The wise men will bow down before the throne. And at his feet they'll cast their golden crowns. When the man comes around. Whoever is unjust, let him be unjust still. Whoever is righteous, let him be righteous still. Whoever is filthy, let him be filthy still. Listen to the words long written down when the man comes around. Hear the trumpets, hear the pipers, 100 million angels singing. Multitudes are marching to the big kettle drum. Voices calling, voices crying. Some are born and some are dying. It's Alpha and Omega's kingdom come. And the whirlwind is in the thorn tree. The virgins are all trimming their wicks. The whirlwind is in the thorn tree. It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. In measured 100 weight and penny pound, when the man comes around.
And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts, and I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death. And hell followed with him.
Well, good morning, friends. So, yes, that's a little bit of a different opening than you might have been expecting for this message today. That was one of the last songs that Johnny Cash wrote and recorded before he died. I remember hearing it for the first time on CBC Radio as I was driving in my car, I think in the fall of 2002. I remember as the song came on and I knew Johnny Cash was close to death and this song. And I remember tears coming to my eyes as I was driving in the car. And I remember thinking, does this CBC announcer even have any idea of the meaning of that song? Johnny Cash is someone who read the Bible daily for almost all of his adult life. And so that song is a combination of images, mostly from Revelation, but there's some thoughts there from Old Testament prophets and from the Gospels. These were thoughts on his mind as he knew that death was approaching. He would die about a year after that song was released. This was also the time, if you remember, the fall of 2002, when we were remembering the first anniversary of 9/11 and that massive change in world politics during that time. And there's a phrase there in that song, "the whirlwind in the thorn tree," that actually combines two biblical images. The presence of God, often in the Old Testament, is referred to as a whirlwind, coming and sweeping around and pushing things out in front of it. And of course, the thorn tree is the burning bush where God spoke to Moses in the desert. So Cash's point is that when God shows up, things are going to happen. Whirlwinds, burning thorn trees. Alpha and Omega's kingdom is coming. And are we ready, like the virgins in Jesus' parable, who are trimming the wicks of their candles, getting ready? They're waiting for the bridegroom to appear. All those thoughts show up in today's message. And that connects to the theme of our series, this a call to faithful endurance, ready and waiting for the arrival until the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. And so we come to the end of all things when God Almighty and the Lamb who was slain renew all things according to God's intention from the beginning of all things. Last week, we saw the destruction of Babylon and the world systems of political, economic, and military power. And then we had that great worship service, "Hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns," in chapter 19. Directly following that worship service, John says, "I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses, and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." Okay, so look at those two images here. Can you tell me what's different between these two images I have? It's interesting. If you search on Google for a picture of the heavenly warrior of Revelation 19, 90% of the images that you'll see that pop up there show you a picture of Jesus coming with a sword in his hand. Not a sword coming from his mouth. Those are two very different images. In this passage, the rider on the horse is called Faithful and True. He's also called the Word of God. And elsewhere in Scripture, we read that the Word of God is like a sword. When Jesus comes at this point in the Revelation, he's coming with the truth, with the Word of God that pushes aside the lies and the deceit of the evil one. Jesus is not coming to conquer and crush people. He's coming to make a way for the truth of God. Those who ignore the truth will suffer. They will be pushed aside because we're getting ready for the arrival of the Holy One. So here we are, coming to the final section of John's Revelation. We're coming to the time when all things will be made right in this story he's telling. So let me just summarize what happens following the arrival of that heavenly warrior in chapters 19 and 20. So firstly, we're told that the heavenly warrior captures that beast that we've been looking at and throws him into the fiery lake. His followers, those who worship the beast, are put to death by the sword of truth. It's interesting. Is that a real physical death, or is it just a destruction of the lies and the deceit? It's not really clear. And then the evil one, Satan, the dragon, is bound up and thrown into the abyss for 1,000 years. And after this, we have the 1,000-year reign of Christ with those who were martyred for their faith in him. At the end of that time, Satan is released from the abyss, and then it says, finally captured and thrown into the fiery lake himself. And then we have the great white throne judgment of all people according to their deeds. And then it says, finally, death itself is defeated and death is thrown into that fiery lake. And so now the earth is ready. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now amongst the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God." So first of all, let's recognize that the future is not about us going up to heaven for the rest of time to be with God. The future is about God coming down to be present amongst us. There's a case to be made, yes, that believers who die in Christ before this Revelation 21 day that's described here, if people die these days in Christ, they may go to an interim place, an in-between place, where we're in the presence of God. If you think of those millions and multitudes gathered around the throne that we saw earlier in John's vision, people who've already gone on in the faith, they're there. But that's not the final story. The final story is not us up there on the clouds someplace. The final story, what we're told here at the end of the biblical record, is that the holy people of God, the New Jerusalem, the bride of Christ, is coming down out of heaven to earth. And this is where God will take up residence. What's it going to look like when God takes up residence here on earth? He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." And then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." In a sense, there will be no longer a cause for tears. The past hurts and struggles will be comforted by the touch of God wiping away our tears. this broken way of life that we struggle with here these days, this is going to pass away. I'm making everything new. John, write this down. That's God talking to John this time. It's not Jesus. It's actually God speaking to John. It's not the angel. God says, write this down. This is going to happen. And then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. God saying, this is what I had in mind all along. You and me and refreshment together as a family. Those who are victorious, those who overcome, they will inherit this. So that phrase, those who are victorious, is a repetition, really, of Jesus' words to the seven churches at the beginning of this revelation. Remember at the end of each challenge to the seven churches, he said, if you overcome, if you are victorious, if you get through these troubling times, if you overcome the difficulties, if you persevere, if you faithfully endure, as he says elsewhere in Revelation, if you get through to the end, you will sit down beside me right here. Let's carry on. One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came and said to me, come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great mountain high. And he showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. Now, for many of us, I think, we imagine the New Jerusalem as a place built by God that we believers go to live in with God. But that's not what's being explained to John here. We might say, just as the church is not a place or a building, the church is actually the people of God who have the living presence of Jesus amongst us, yes, in a particular place. And so we have to see that the New Jerusalem is the people of God rather than a city built. Just like the church is not a building, the church is the people who gather. See, John is trying to describe what he's seeing, and he's trying to understand what this angel is telling him. The people of God, who are the bride of the Lamb, and that's image from the Old Testament, through the Gospels, through Paul's writings, that image, the people of God, we are the bride of the Lamb, who is the bridegroom. The people of God, the bride of the Lamb, is this living city, the New Jerusalem. So John carries on describing here, I did not see a temple in this city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on, for the glory of God gives the city light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into the city, the people of God. So this is the other shift for John. In the Old Testament Jerusalem city, there was a temple, a building in the middle of the city. And we know in the Old Testament that God's presence could come and inhabit that place. You could find God there, so to speak. But now this New Jerusalem is not bricks and mortar, but actually the people of God. And there's no need for a temple place or a temple building, because God and the Lamb kind of permeate the whole thing in the way that the sun or the lamps just kind of fill up the space. And so the light of God, it says, illuminates every corner. Because as those who have been faithful to the end, we are full of the presence of God. And that's the significance of this bride and bridegroom image. John's trying to describe spiritual realities, and he's using language that really, for the most part, comes from the Old Testament. He's saying, we and God, like the bride and the bridegroom, have become one flesh, so to speak. In this new space, this new time, we will be in complete union with God. And the nations, the peoples of the earth, it says, will finally walk in the light of God. And all those kings who brought their gifts to the Roman emperors will now realize that all their power and authority is overruled by this city, this new Jerusalem, by this God, who is not made of stone, sitting lifeless in a temple down the street. And so that contrast between these two kingdoms, these two cities, that is the heart of John's message in this whole revelation. Babylon, Rome, is deceptive in its attraction. These earthly powers, kingdoms, empires, nations, are the dwellings of demons, we read last week. And last week, God says, come out of her, my people. These earthly powers will be destroyed one day. So come out, don't be deceived. And then the kingdom of God, the new Jerusalem, is so completely unlike the earthly kingdoms. This kingdom is not built by military power and violence, but through the sacrificial death and resurrection of Jesus, the Lamb of God, and filled through and through with the presence of the living God Almighty. That Greek word that John used, the pantocrator, the one who sustains or holds all things together. And finally, no longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face. So this, of course, is a reference to the curse brought upon all humanity by the rebellion and disobedience of Adam and Eve in the garden. So Genesis 3 says that they hid from God when they realized their mistake. They turned their faces away. And throughout Scripture, we see this repeated, where human beings are not allowed to see the face of God, like Moses or Elijah, because God's holiness is really too much for our selfishness, for our sin. But now, in these final verses of the whole of Scripture here at the end of Revelation, now the curse has been removed. The sacrificed lamb has broken the grip of our selfishness, our self-centeredness. And now, for the first time, we're once again allowed to see the face of God. It's interesting, over this pandemic, there's been a lot of times we haven't been able to see people's faces. And that's one thing we have struggled with. Just think about what it will mean to be unmasked in the presence of God.
One day you'll make everything new, Jesus.
One day you will bind every word. The former things shall all pass away. No more tears. One day you'll make sense of it all, Jesus. One day every question resolved, every anxious thought left behind, and no more fear. And when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. One day we'll see face to face Jesus. Is there a greater vision of grace? And in a moment we shall be changed on that day. And one day we'll be free, free indeed, Jesus. One day all the struggle will cease, and we will see your glory revealed on that day. And when we all to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. It's when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that.
So that's our desire, isn't it? It's to see Jesus face to face. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears this say, come. Let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who wishes come and take the free gift of the water of life. He who testifies to these things, that's Jesus, says, yes, I am coming soon. Amen. And that's where John finishes. Come, Lord Jesus. Yes, we want this day when we are in your presence. So that's where we're going to conclude today. Come, Lord Jesus. We know we need all the things that he wants to do to bring about new life. We want our tears wiped away. We want the curse broken. Come, Lord Jesus. So there is more to say as we reflect on this whole revelation, but we're going to take a break for a week. Okay, we have a guest speaker in our service next week here in our live, and so we'll take a break, and then the week after, I'm going to pull the pieces together for this exploration of revelation that we've done through this summer. And so come back to what does all this mean? What's its significance for us in this time? So, friends, have a good week. We trust that as you desire to be in the presence of God, you can be assured that our God is waiting right there. Take care.